Galatians chapter 5, Galatians chapter 5, we'll be reading verses 1 through 14. Galatians 5, beginning in verse 1. The Word of God says this: Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. Be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say to you that if you be circumcised, Christ shall profit to nothing. For I testify against every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Christ has become of no effect to you, whoever of you are justified by the law. You are fallen from grace. For we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Jesus Christ, if the circumcision avails anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which works by love. You have run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? What persuasion comes not of him that calls you? A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in you through the Lord that you will be none otherwise minded, but he that troubles you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. And I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I yet suffer persecution? They will see a sense of the cross to peace. I would they were even cut off which trouble you. For brethren, you have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. So, Lord, in prayer. Father, give us an understanding of your word. Father, please. Help us, Father, not just to hear of your word, but also as we read your word, Father, may you give us faith, and that faith, Father, produce love, and that love be seen and demonstrated through our service to one another. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. May be seated. So, the next couple weeks, we're going to be going over the one another commands in the book of Galatians. So, in order to properly interpret them, we need to understand what is happening in the book of Galatians. To understand the book of Galatians, we need to understand the covenant. And so, today we're going to be looking at the end of the message of the phrase, serve one another. But in order to understand serve one another, you need to understand the covenant, the gospel, what's going on in Galatia, and all the way up until we get to chapter 5. So, to understand the Bible properly, you need to understand that there is the Old Testament and the New Testament. The word testament literally is a word that's still used today in our law system for a legal agreement, a binding agreement, like a last will and testament. Another word for testament is covenant, and this is the word that you'll find most often in Scripture. And a covenant is simply an agreement between two or more persons. It's a legal term, it's an agreement. Sometimes if you buy property today, it'll come with a covenant. In other words, deed restrictions, another word for it. Like, you're agreeing to only do this with the property in this, you know, gated community when you buy it. This is a covenant, it's an agreement. So the Bible has the Old Covenant and the Old Testament, the Old Agreement, and it has the New Covenant or the New Testament or the New Agreement. I think they're very clearly seen in John chapter 1 and verse 17. So it says this: the law was given by Moses. That is the Old Covenant. It's the covenant of work, of many names. It's the covenant of work. It's the covenant of Moses. It's the covenant on Mount Sinai. It's the covenant of law. The law comes through Moses. That is the Old Covenant, the Old Testament. But grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. The New Covenant is the covenant of grace. So what are these covenants, and what are these Galatians? Well, the Old Covenant, the covenant of work, or the covenant of law, is basically an agreement that God entered into with mankind. And you can summarize this agreement like this: if you keep my law perfectly, I will bless you infinitely. If you break my law, I will curse you infinitely. In Deuteronomy, which literally means the second reading of the law, right before the nation of Israel goes into the promised land, they go over this covenant. And at the end of Deuteronomy, what they have is what is a section known as the cursings and the blessings. And this is something
they're supposed to recite. And if you do all these things, God will bless you. If you don't do all these things, God will curse you. So, for example, in Deuteronomy 27:26, curse is the disease that confirms not all the words of this law to do them. If you break God's law, you will be cursed. Okay? Similarly, in chapter 28 of Deuteronomy, you have the one who observes and does all these commandments, which I command you, all these blessings will come on you. You keep God's law, you will be blessed. Well, there is a problem with this agreement. The problem does not lie with God. God has kept his agreement with man. All those who have broken his law, he has cursed. And all those who have kept his law, he has blessed. So the problem is not with God. The problem is not with the agreement or the terms of the agreement. Okay? When you look at God's law, how many of you want to live in a society where murder is okay? Death is okay. Lying is okay. Rape is okay. No, when you begin to look at God's law, the problem is not with God's law. So the problem is not with God. The problem is not with the agreement. Where does the problem lie? It lies with us. We have proven that we are incapable of doing what God requires of us. That's why, as we read in Galatians 3, we are under the curse, because we have not done everything that God commands of us. Even on our best day, we still fall short of the glory of God. So the new covenant is a new agreement. And this is pictured all the way back when Adam and Eve fell, with the coming of the Messiah. Jeremiah speaks specifically of a new covenant that's coming. This new covenant is not an agreement between God and man. The new covenant is an agreement between God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And the agreement is this: that God himself, in the person of his Son, Jesus Christ, will become a man to fulfill all the requirements of God's law on behalf of sinful men. Okay, that's the agreement. Okay, you and I are the recipients, if we believe in Jesus Christ, we're the recipients of this agreement, but we have nothing to do with this agreement. And that's the new covenant, is that Jesus becomes man, and Jesus lives a sinful life. Sinless life. If you look at Jesus living a sinless life, one of the things that you'll find constantly being brought up by Jesus is this idea of fulfilling the law. Why was Jesus baptized? What did he tell John? To fulfill all righteousness. What did he say in the Sermon on the Mount? Not one jot or one tittle of the law will fail until all is fulfilled. Jesus came to live a sinless life to fulfill all the requirements of the old covenant, so that the infinite blessings of God will be available. But the part of the agreement is what is known as the substitutionary atonement, where Jesus agrees as man to take man's curse and man's sin and die under the wrath of God, so that those who turn from their sin and believe in Jesus Christ might be given his righteousness and his eternal life. That is what is known as the gospel. That is what is known as grace. Why? Because you do absolutely nothing to merit it. As Jonathan Edwards said, the only thing you contribute to your salvation is the sin which made it necessary. It is 100% God doing the work. That's why this is a new agreement, and it's an agreement of grace that is brought to Jesus Christ. This is summarized probably best in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. For he, that is God, has made him, that is Jesus Christ, to be sin for us. To what end? That we might be made the righteousness of God in him. This is how sinners are made righteous. And that's because the righteous one, Jesus Christ, is made sin for us. So this is the old covenant and the new covenant. This is the gospel of grace. To understand what is going on in Galatia, you need to understand first the Jewish background of Christianity. Up until Acts chapter 10, the entirety of Christianity is Jews. 100% until Acts chapter 10. Okay? Now, if you look at Christianity in its proper understanding, Christianity is a sect of Judaism. Okay? That's what it is, and that's what we call the New Testament. Okay? How does it affect Judaism? Well, the Jews have the Old Covenant, they have the law, and in that law, it prophesies of a Messiah to come. If you were to look at Jews today, you will find that there are Orthodox Jews, and there are Reformed Jews, and there's all kinds of different groups of Jews, but there's one group of Jews called Messianic Jews. Guess what Messianic Jews are? Christians. That's what they are. Okay? That's what the entire church was up until Acts chapter 10. It was Messianic Jews. It was Jews who found the Messiah. That's who Jesus is. Jesus is the Messiah prophesied in the Old Testament. So to get to Acts chapter 10, okay, even the Ethiopian eunuch, okay, you know, the black guy from Africa, he was a convert to Judaism before he believed in Jesus. So again, everyone too, up until Acts chapter 10 with Peter's vision. So what this means, before the gospel goes to the Gentiles, what this means is that the early church did not have within their mindset that there was a place for Gentiles among the covenant people of God. That just did not compute with them. This is why God had to talk to Peter three times before Peter was willing to obey. Okay? Remember, Peter tells God no continuously because he doesn't understand what God is telling him because of his background in Judaism. But God opens their eyes, going to Acts chapter 10 following, to see that Gentiles are part of the covenant of grace. That all who believe, whether Jew or Gentile, are included in this covenant. So this brings up a question that's important. That's the question throughout the New Testament that's addressed in Acts 15 with the Jerusalem Council. And that is, do you have to be a Jew to be a Christian? Do you have to convert to Judaism in order to believe that Jesus is the Messiah? And you remember at this time, in the mindset of the church, to be a Jew is to be part of the first people of God. To be a Gentile is to be a first pagan. Okay? So this huge controversy is addressed in Acts chapter 15, but also a significant portion of Paul's writings deal with this controversy. The book of Romans deals with this, the book of Ephesians deals with this, and the entirety of the book of Galatians is about this. That's what Galatians is about. So if you don't understand that, when you read the book of Galatians, you're going to miss the whole point. Okay? So in his writing, one of the things you'll notice from the Apostle Paul is Paul begins with his theology, and then he does application. So in the book of Romans, where were all the one another commands? At the end of the book, Corinth. Well, this is what Jesus did. Here's how you live in light of it. When we get to the book of Ephesians, guess where all the one another commands are going to be? At the end of the book, guess where they all are in Galatians. At the end of the book, guess where they were in verse 19. At the end of the book, Corinth. Well, this is the theology. This is the theology. Here's how you live in light of it. So if we look at the one another commands and don't understand the theology, we will miss the whole point of the one another commands that we're going to be looking at. Okay? So he writes, I'll kind of give you a hint here. He deals a lot with the purpose of the law. Okay? And the purpose of the law is to expose our sinfulness, not to make us sinful, and make us righteous, and to show us our need of a Savior. Okay? He uses the illustration that the law is our school teacher. We'll reference that later. So who is the church of Galatia? Well, Galatia is not a city. Galatia is a province. You look at the very beginning of the book, it says, to the churches, plural, in Galatia. Because Galatia would be a province about the size of New Jersey. It would be filled with pagan idolatry. And this church was probably started by Paul and Barnabas on their first missionary journey. You look at Acts 14 and verse 6, it speaks of the cities of Lycaonia. And then it says, and unto the region that lies round about. Okay? Lycaonia was the province that bordered the province of Galatia. So if you were to ask, you know, where did the church in Georgia come from? And you found that Paul went to Florida and preached in all the cities of Florida and the surrounding states. Well, that's where it came from. That region that lies around about Lycaonia, that is Galatia. Okay, so that's where the church begins, is Paul preaching there. Paul's method of preaching, if you look at Scripture, Romans 1, verse 16, he always began with the Jew. It was to the Jew first. You can see this in Acts 17, when he comes to Thessalonica. Where does he go? He goes first to the synagogue. That's his manner. That's what he does. Everywhere he goes, he tries to find the synagogue and preach there. Well, if we're going to see, God's law is like a picture, and Jesus Christ is the reality. I went to So I actually decided to meet with somebody I had never met before. Okay? So I went online and I looked at the website and I saw his picture. Why? Because I did not want to have to go table to table asking, are you Patrick? Are you Patrick? Are you Patrick? Yes. I wanted to be able to recognize him when he came in. Well, if you were a Jew who from a child had known the Holy Scriptures, when someone comes and says, hey, here's the Jesus guy, you go, oh, I recognize him from all of the commands, all of the sacrifices. I recognize him from Isaiah 53. I recognize him from Psalm 22. I recognize him from absolutely every single prophecy. Okay? That's where he would begin. And then when the Jews rejected him, he would then go preach to the Gentiles. Now, there weren't very many Jews in Galatia, so the vast majority of the Galatians that Paul is writing to are Gentiles. But as soon as Paul left, Jewish believers, okay, Christians, use the term very loosely, came to help the Galatians understand that part that Paul left out. Okay? So they attempted to kind of add to what Paul was saying. And so they come in, and this group of people is called the Judaizers, and you'll read that in Galatians. You'll find the reference to the Judaizers, okay? And so that comes kind of helps them understand Scripture. And the Gentiles in Galatia very quickly left John and began to follow the Judaizers. Now, the arguments of the Judaizers are, before we have a tendency to condemn Pharisees without looking in the mirror, okay? So I want to give you the argument of the Judaizers. This should terrify you, by the way, okay? Here's the argument. We should obey Scripture. How many of y'all agree with the Judaizers? We obey Scripture? Okay. Next one. Okay. We must pursue holiness as Christians. How many agree with that one? Okay. So the Galatians aren't that stupid to get deceived, but we all are as well. Now, their argument on obeying Scripture and holiness center on two main points. And I want you to notice this one, okay? Because it will terrify you. It should, and this should make you study the Bible. The first one is circumcision, and that is this. Okay? Genesis 17, verse 14. What does it say? The uncircumcised, that soul will be cut off from his people. He has broken my covenant. Now, according to Genesis 17, 14, can you be part of the covenant people of God if you're not circumcised? No. Think it would be possible, forget about Galatians, do you think it would be possible for me to teach a Bible study to the book of Genesis, come to Genesis 17, and tell all of you, every man, if you have not been circumcised as part of your conversion to Judaism, you're not part of the covenant people of God? What do you do with that, right? Well, I'm going to tell you what to do with it so you'll get saved, okay? But before we get all high and mighty, I can name pastors and others in this very area. I know of a pastor who convinced a man who came to faith in Christ that he could not be a good Christian unless he got circumcised. In the 50s, he went and got circumcised. Okay? One, because that's what the Bible says. Well, we need to be very careful. People who are ignorant, but they're ignorant. Okay? They couldn't understand that. People think they know everything about the Bible. Well, I've written, that's what the Bible says. How many of y'all have heard, well, you Christians don't obey the Bible? Well, if you read the entirety of the Bible, you would understand what the point of circumcision is. Notice this in the law, Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 16. Circumcise your heart. According to what Samuel was told, man looks on the outward appearance, God looks at the heart. Circumcision is a picture of a inward reality that God is after. Are you able to circumcise your heart? The answer to that is no. So who is going to circumcise your heart? Well, if you keep reading the Bible, Deuteronomy chapter 30, what do you find? Yahweh, your God, will circumcise your heart. We must look away from ourselves and our own outward religious deeds for God to do something within us. Circumcision is a picture of a transformation that must take place within me result. This is important to understand Galatians. What is the end result of the circumcision of the heart? Okay? To love God. And now notice this. Not only to love God, but in the blessings and the cursings, what was the curse in the Garden of Eden? When you eat, you will die. The wages of sin is death. You get the God of it, eternal life. So a synonym for blessings in the Old Covenant is that you may live. Who is it who gets the blessing of eternal life? Who is it? The one who's circumcised in heart, not the one who's circumcised in flesh. The circumcision of the flesh was merely a picture of which regeneration is the reality. When someone is changed by Jesus Christ, this is exactly what it's talking about in Ezekiel 37, when God says to the nation of Israel, I will take out your heart of stone and put within you a heart of flesh. That's the picture. The other thing that they taught besides the circumcision, again, is the Passover. You'll see this reference a lot in the book of Galatians. Numbers chapter 9, verse 13. The man that doesn't keep the Passover, what happens to him? The same soul shall be cut off from among his people. That man shall bear his sin. Do you think we can preach a sermon on that and say that if you do not observe the Passover, you can't be a Christian? What things to say, isn't it? Well, let me ask you, is the Passover a picture or is the Passover the reality? What is it that 1 Corinthians chapter 5 tells us, verse 7? What is the reality? Jesus Christ is our Passover. To believe in Jesus Christ is the reality that the Passover is merely a picture. Okay? And by the way, there's nothing wrong with pictures. You want to circumcise your children, praise God. If you want to help observe the Passover, praise God. There's nothing wrong with that. But that is not your standing before God. You see, the Passover was a picture that death is coming to you. And there must be a spotless sacrifice that covers you so that death might pass over you. Jesus Christ is the spotless lamb whose blood was shed, who covers all those who believe. And those who believe in Jesus Christ, his blood covers them. And what happens to death? Death passes over all those who are in Christ. The Passover is a picture. Jesus Christ is the reality. So when we look at this, you can understand how the Galatians, as new believers, could very quickly become confused. You also need to understand why Paul told Timothy to study and rightly divide the word of truth, because you can easily get deceived by modern-day Judaizers, legalistic Pharisees who infiltrate the church and say, well, I just want you to obey Scripture. You need to understand the totality of Scripture. Remember, how was Satan tempting Jesus? By quoting Scripture out of context. You need to study, okay? One of the central parts of the Judaizer's message is this, is that if you only preach grace, people will live in all manner of sin. You can't just say, believe in Jesus. You have to have law. You have to have rules. Because otherwise, there is nothing to restrain men from doing evil. If you say, turn from your sin and self-righteousness and believe in Jesus, but you don't preach on murder, guess what? All the believers in Jesus are going to start killing each other. If you don't preach on modesty, everybody's going to start sleeping with everybody. And if you don't start preaching on rock music, everybody's going to go into idolatry. Okay? You understand what I'm talking about? This is modern day today, the same message. Okay? So, what does Paul do? Paul writes to the Galatians to address the right use of the law. So the purpose of the law is to point us to Christ. Again, the law is a school teacher. That's what he says of us. So let me explain what he says, school teacher. Part of the job of a teacher is to help you understand something so that when you see it in real life, you understand it. So let me give an example of this. How many of y'all have ever heard of A squared, C squared, equals B squared? Okay? You go, well, I hated math and geometry. Okay, but A squared was C squared, so C squared. Okay? That is the way
single triangle. And you fell asleep and you don't care about it. But if you dropped out of school and you worked on a construction site, you would learn what's known as a 3-4-5 trick. Okay? 3-4-5 trick is the way to find whether something is square. You draw a line that's 3 feet this way, 4 feet that way, and when there's 5 feet between the 2 points, then this is the right angle. And I've worked construction with people who had no idea about Pythagoras and right angles and triangles and a squared plus b squared equals c squared. But I had learned from my mother what a squared plus b squared equals c squared is. And when they started doing it, I said, oh, I know exactly what this is. This is a 3-4-5 trick. It's how you determine the right angle. So they go with the 3-4-5 trick, you know? But that's what it is. That's the whole job of a teacher. Is that when you see the reality, you go, oh, I know this one. I know exactly what's going on here. That's the whole point of the law. You're a sinner and you need a savior. Of your Jesus, on the cross. I've seen this. He's a sacrifice. He's a savior. He's what the law's purpose was. He also writes to show them that the Judaizers are not their friends, they're enemies of the gospel, seeking to drag them away from the covenant of grace. And one of the main points of Galatians is that Jesus plus anything is not the gospel. Jesus plus anything is not the gospel. So he wants to show the same thing he told, the same thing he tells Titus in chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. That when you are saved by grace, it changes the way you do it. If you just preach grace, people are going to live in all manner of wickedness. No, 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 no. The grace of God that brings salvation, but what? Verse 12, it teaches us. What does God's saving grace teach us? To deny ungodliness and worldly lust. And what does God's grace teach us to do? To live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Now, this brings us to the text of chapter 5, as we get closer and closer to the one other commandment we're looking at today. In verse 1, the Apostle Paul tells us that Christ has given us liberty from the law. Manifest, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. Do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. We are free from the law, right, as we are part of the new covenant, saved by grace through faith in Christ. In verses 2 through 4, he tells the Galatians, to be entangled in the law is to deny the gospel of grace. In verse 2, he says, if you're circumcised, and this is not talking about someone from a Judeo-Christian background that's circumcised, he's talking about if you, as a grown pagan Galatian who has come to faith in Christ, believe that getting circumcised improves your standing before God, right? It does you no good. Christ does you no good. Why? Because, in verse 3, your standing before God is now based upon your performance. And you have to perform to keep the entirety of the law. In verse 4, the work of Christ means nothing at that point. If you have to do something to merit God's favor, then what Christ has done is worthless. It is all dependent upon you and your work. That's what it means by falling from grace. You have moved away from the covenant of grace, and you've gone back to the covenant of works. So in verses 5 and 6, he explains to us again what does God require of man. If it is finished, the dividing words of Christ, if all of salvation is accomplished, if the new covenant is an agreement between the members of the Trinity, then what is required of man? Well, we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness. How is that righteousness going to come? By faith. Verse 6, for in Jesus Christ neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything. What is it that matters? Faith. But it's important to note this, because we're going to come back to this in verse 13. Faith which works by love. In other words, saving faith in Jesus Christ produces what? What does circumcision of the heart produce, according to Deuteronomy? Love for God. That's what happens when you are born again. What is the first fruit of the Spirit? Love. Okay? That's what happens. The love of God is shed abroad within our heart. So we didn't get to verses 7 through 9. Verses 7 through 9, he tells them that the Judaizers have jeopardized their walk with the Lord. In verse 7, who hinders you? And what the Judaizers? And notice this, that you should not obey the truth. What was the argument of the Judaizers? You're not obeying Scripture. No. Okay? Obeying Scripture is running the Christ. Now, let me give you an
go home. Okay? Lady was at the first service, but she was at home. I go home and I see her. And I walk right past her to her picture, which is hanging on the wall. And I take the picture off the wall and I kick it. And I take the picture to the couch and I say, "How was your day?" And I tell her about my morning. How offensive is that to my wife, who is actually standing there in flesh and blood? It's extremely offensive that you would reject the reality for the picture. No. You're not obeying the picture. The whole point of the picture is that you would recognize the reality. That's the whole point. There's nothing wrong with having pictures. There's nothing wrong with having a picture of your wife. But if you kiss the picture and don't kiss your wife, you're going to have some problems. I'm just telling you that right now, guys. Okay? But you're going to have problems. Why? Because the picture's there to remind you of the reality, not a substitute for reality. And so there's obedience to the scripture was not obedience at all. It was disobedience. Why? Because what they needed to be was focused on Christ, not focused on their external works and actions. In verse 10 to 12, the Apostle Paul says in very firm words that the Judaizers need to be rejected. Notice he speaks about the one who troubles you, verse 10, will bear his judgment. In verse 12, he says, "I would they were even cut off that troubles you." Now, some of your English translations will translate this as sort of emasculate. The Greek word is very graphic. If I can say it lightly, I hope the rabbi sees it when he gives you your circumcision. It literally means to castrate. And what you're saying here is, I want them cut off. I want them kicked out of the church. I want their power over you gone. I want their influence gone. I want their teaching gone. I want every single thing that they have tried to do to you gone. That they're exercising power and lies and deceptions over the Galatian church and drawing them away from Christ. Now that brings us to our text today. You know, why is it all this time? Well, the text is really easy if you understand the theology. It's really easy, okay? Verse 13, "Brethren, you be called to liberty, only use not your liberty for an occasion to the flesh." In other words, we have been set free from the law, praise God, but that is not freedom to go to people. Not freedom to go rape and pillage and all of those other things. Okay? Now, if you understand grace, you will love this quote by Augustine, or Augustine, however you want to say it. If you are a legalist, it will bother you. Okay? Love God and do what you will. That is the new covenant. That's the book of Galatians. That is Christianity. Now, if you're a legalist, you don't understand the gospel, you go, no. What happens in the new covenant? When the heart of stone is removed, what does Ezekiel, what's what tells Ezekiel? When he puts in the heart of flesh, what is he going to cause us to do? He's going to cause us to walk in his ways and keep his statutes and observe his commandments. Why? Well, it's because it's God who works in you both to what? To will and then to do what? Give you pleasure. You see, if I am given a new heart, guess what that new heart's going to want to do? What reason God? If I am, we think this is a different sacrament. If I am a partaker of the divine nature, Christ is in me. Okay? I have a new heart, a heart that's filled with Christ, a heart that has the law of God written on it. What is that heart going to want? Godliness. What's going to will? Because the issue is not, oh, no. We got to add some law to the grace. No, you're not preaching grace. You're not preaching regeneration. It changed heart. Because if your heart is changed, your desires are going to change, and you're going to want to do it with God. That's the first part of verse 13. But then we come to the second part of verse 13. I put the Greek here because I don't know if you can read Greek, but it's pretty easy. Okay? The phrase here that is translated in verse 13 is "by love serve one another." Literally, it's dia, which is translated "by," but means in Greek the channel of an act, or the means whereby something is done, okay? Which in English is "by." But the channel of the act, the means by which something's done. But then there's a word that's here in the Greek that we don't have in English. And that is case, which means do or this or that. It's a word that's given. Okay? And that's got to be a flow. The channel, the means by which. What is the channel? What love? What love? Well, when was the last time you mentioned love? Verse 6. And what love is he referencing? The love that faith produces. Circumcision of the heart produces that you will love God. And by that love, by means of that love, the love of God shed abroad in your heart, what are you supposed to do? Well, the verb is dulao. It comes from this word dulao, which literally means a slave. Okay, like slave, like enchanted slave, like bought and sold that property slave. This is commanding you to be a slave to other believers. That's literally what it says. Okay, you don't like it? Slave, you don't. No. Okay? That is not bad. We'll get to why in just a minute. But the command is, by that love that faith produces, that is the means by which you are going to humble yourself and serve other believers. Which brings us to verse 14. For all the law is fulfilled in one word. And what is that? You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now, I want you to think on this. When it comes to doing something good towards another person, there are two possible motivations. One is Old Covenant law. If I don't do this kind of thing to you, God is going to curse me. And if I don't do this kind of thing to you, God is not going to bless me. So let me ask you, if law is the basis of my motivation for action, what is that by definition? Selfishness. I don't really care about you. I only care about me. I really don't care about God. I only care about what God will do for me. It's all about me. I mean, if you remember the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus talked about how you can pray and you can pray. You can pray for the praise of man or you can pray for the glory of God. It's a heart motivation. One guy's fasting, one guy's fasting. One guy got hate, one guy got love. Why? Because one person is fasting from a motivation for self. And guess what happens when you become selfish? All manner of wickedness, that's what Paul's going to tell the Galatians. If you go to the flesh, if you go back to the law, it's going to produce corruption. Have you ever noticed that in legalistic cults, they have some of the highest rates of child molestation? They have some of the most darkest, depraved actions that take place among these supposed holiness groups. Why? Because it's not about God, and it's not about His glory. You're not doing this because you love God. You're not doing this because you love others. You're doing this for yourself. And guess what happens to selfish people? Selfish people that will use you for their standing before God will use you. Okay, that's what happens. That's the mechanism whereby the law, the Apostle Paul talks about how it stirs up sin. Why? Because it's a motivation for self. That's the motivation. Obviously, this leads to comparison to others and comparison leads to pride and all kinds of corruption. But the gospel has a different focus. What is the focus of the gospel? Well, in Hebrews chapter 12, what does it tell us? Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. If Jesus has already done everything to affect my standing before God, I'm free to do whatever I want, right? And if I have a new heart, what am I going to want to do? Love God and love my neighbor. But see, if I fix my eyes on Jesus, where are my eyes no longer? They're no longer on me. I don't have to serve you to merit God's favor. I already have God's favor. I don't have to not pick you up in the parking lot so I can go to heaven. I'm already going to heaven. So if you hit me, I can turn the other cheek because my response is not what makes my standing before God. I'm set free. I'm no longer living for self. I'm living to the one who died and gave himself for me. I'm living a life out of love for Christ and gratitude for what you've done. This leads to selflessness. This leads to humility. My standing before God is not being the best preacher in the world. So who cares? I just try to be faithful. My standing before God is not being the most prominent member of the church. I don't need to tell you that. But my standing before God is Jesus Christ. I can freely confess my sin. Why? Because my standing before God is not based upon your opinion of me. It's based upon Jesus Christ. And if I listen to the gospel, guess what? I'm still free. I'm free from man's opinion. I'm free from having to do things. And so what do? I'm able to selflessly love other people. Okay? And that's exactly what love is, by the way. John 15, verse 15, what is love? Greater man than God has no man than this, and what? The man lay down his life for his friends. See, Barnes nails it. Let's listen to Barnes' quote. When there is love, there is no servitude. Duty is pleasant, and offices of kindness begin. In our world today, our backward God-hating folk is sometimes hear women talk about how just slaves to their newborn. Have you ever heard a mother who loves their child calling it slavery? How many of you grandparents view it as slavery to watch the baby? That's not slavery. That is joy. That is happiness. Yes, you may have to get up in the middle of the night. I'm talking with my wife, and she loves babies, and she has, I tell people before, she hasn't slept since Michael was born. Okay? She's a walking miracle, a enigma of science. But I know when we have our last baby, and she's not woken up at 2 o'clock in the morning because some baby won't cry and take us, she's not safe. You know why? Because she loves her children. It's not. I could give you 1,000 illustrations of this. I know a man, one of the happiest men I've ever met, who for several years his wife was in there. She couldn't get up. Every morning he would have to go in there. He would have to change her. He would have to change her clothes. He'd have to give her a bath. He'd have to pick her up out of the bed, put her in the wheelchair. He'd have to push her everywhere. And when I talk about man, I'm not talking about a 30-year-old man. I'm talking about a man who was probably 80 years old, who still would pick his wife up and put her in a wheelchair and give her everything. Never complained. You know why? Because he loved his wife and wanted to be with her. But then, it wasn't a good reason. It was love. And if you love someone, you can act like a slave towards them, and it doesn't feel like slavery at all. Why? Because you care about them. That's why the Apostle Paul constantly calls himself Christ's slave. You see, that's the whole point of this passage of Scripture. The whole point of this, if you look at the entire theology of Galatians 6, is that if Jesus Christ died for you, and you believe that, your heart is changed. And part of that change of heart is the love of God begins to flow through your life. And that love of God flows like a channel towards other Christians and causes you to serve them in the lowliest way. You see, if we just took that command, you could leave here navel-gazing, going, oh, do I serve people or not? Am I enough of a slave? Like, no, you look Jesus said, you'll have no problem serving me anymore. So that's the command. So here's some questions for application. The first one is, are you a part of the covenant people of God? How do you become part of the covenant people of God? Through faith in Jesus Christ. That's it. I'm amazed that no matter how much I preach this, I will still have adults and I will still have children that will come to be engaged. Surely it's not that simple. Yes, it is. Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins, was buried and rose again according to the Scriptures. Do you believe that?
your faith is real? Well, it produces love. Do you see that love being produced in your life? In my devotional time, I started going through 1 John this week. And then 1 John says, by this we know that we are born again. We love the brethren. That's every verse. Love the brethren. 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 That's how we know that our faith is genuine. Do you see a love for the people of God emanating from your life? I remember talking to someone after they came to faith in Christ, and they said, man, the weirdest thing has happened to me. There are these people in my life that I've hated, and I just can't find it to hate them anymore, and I don't know why. But because you are what you are. You have God. You can do what you will. Why do you do what you will? You won't be able to keep that hatred and animosity. Do you see this evidence of your faith? Next question. Are you living a life of selfless love for God and others? And we'll talk away at 49. What motivates you to obey God? Are you motivated out of fear? Fear for what other people will think of you? Fear of what God will do to you? Oh, there is the fear of God. That's biblical. To get what the fear of God shows us, it drives us as a teacher to Jesus Christ to see the love of God. And you know, Scripture tells us perfect love has an fear. That's what happens. The fear of God is good because then it shows you the love that God has for you and it shows you the grace that's not deserved. Why do you want to serve others? Because of other people's opinion, or because it's the most natural thing that you can do after all that Christ has done for you. You love them. You love them and you care for them. That's why you're willing to do those things. So that brings us to the next question. Is your love seen in actually serving other believers? Does your faith produce love? This is the meaning by which you actually serve other people. That's what the text is about. Can you point to tangible ways that you love people? You know, I was thinking about this last week. I know people who are kind of, they're not very physically affectionate, they're not very verbally affectionate, but I know they love me. You know why? Because they'll do anything for me. I know people like that. And you know what? I also know people. They will give me a hug and stab me in the back and stand up. They will tell me how much they love me, but my house could be on fire and driving past my fire truck, and they wouldn't stop because they were meant to do next to you. Y'all know exactly what I'm talking about. And that love is not biblical love. Does your faith produce love, a love that actually is willing to humble yourself as a slave and serve others, and you don't even view it as slavery? You view it as joy. Okay? Is that what Philippians 2 is about? Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. How you came to God's home from the form of a servant, which made the likeness of man. So, friends, it's a question for you to be thinking through. What ways, as Christians, can we serve other people in God? John Gill has a very good way of looking at it. I want to read this quote from him. Gospel liberty and the service of the saints are not at all inconsistent. As we come then to love one another as the new command of Christ, their profession of religion and their relation to each other require so they should show their love by their service as by praying one with and for another, by bearing each other's burdens, empathizing with and communicating to each other and with gentleness, and forbearing with and forgiving one another, by admonishing each other when there's occasion for it, in a meek, tender, and deadly way, by instructing and building up one another on the most holy faith, and by stirring up one another to all the duties of religion private time. I want to close with a quote by John Wesley. And John Wesley, I think, summarizes this entire verse, verse 13, very well. But by love, serve one another, and hereby show that Christ has made you free. What is the demonstration that you have a
become satisfied that Jesus Christ is your Passover and death has passed over you, what is the demonstration of that? Because your faith produces love, not love produces service for others. Do you remember the verse that we started this entire one another study with? What was it? John 17. What does Jesus say? By this shall all men know that you are mine.